success of the Kenshin World. Simon will be joining me very shortly, but for the first 5 minutes, I'm joined by Petronas Yamaha's Fan Racing Team Manager, Wilco Zeelenberg. Wilco, a good opportunity for the bikes to go past to say welcome.
Yeah, it was a very good moment because I did not understand nothing from the first part, but now they're gone, so yeah, thank you very much.
It was a good intro to say what a wonderful job you've done over the past 2 years here in MotoGP, but this year is a new adventure for you and, of course, your new rider, Valentino Rossi. First day yesterday, how did things go?
Yeah, we were very excited to start again because the winter has been a bit longer than normal. But of course, the drama with Fausto, we also need to realize that this COVID situation is still around. And we try to do everything to make this championship work. And of course, we obey all the rules, but it's still around. But we are very happy to start again.
And obviously with Valentino in the box as well, I would imagine brings a change of dynamic with a new rider. Since you've started, you had the same rider lineup. So how have things changed with his addition to the box?
Yeah, it's a big change, you know, when you come and you start your first year with two rookies, and then after 2 years you have Valentino Rossi in your pit box. Of course, our attitude is the same and our ambition is the same, and also our passion is the same. And actually we share a lot of that, even with Vale. So this is very good. But the attention we get and the load of pressure on our shoulders is, of course, very big. You know, Vale is a living legend in this sport. And I think he deserved all the chance to stop whenever he wanted to stop. But for our team to give him the freedom in mind and the pleasure that he wants to ride bikes, that, of course, is very important.
And for you, for so many years, been a part of Jorge's camp when we're going toe-to-toe. What is it like now being on the other side of the garage, being on Valentino's side?
Yeah, it's a little bit the world upside down, I would say. Of course, Vale has been many years in my garage. But of course, when you work with the other rider, you are competitors from each other, you know. But as I see it from a team manager point of view and not being a rider, we have 20 or 21 competitors with everybody, but we don't have enemies, you know. And I think that I always had that with Vale. He was our competitor, but not my enemy, you know. I always have been a very big fan of him when he was performing in those years when he made the show. And I still am, and I think he also respected that, and that's why we never had any problems with each other.
And of course, on the other side of the garage is Franco Morbidelli, the man that we can't forget finished second in the World Championship last year. It seems strange to say this, but with Franco having had the success that he had last year, what do you think he can teach Valentino this year to try for the pair of them to be successful?
Well, of course, we know the problems with our bikes that you have is that we need to be on first and second row after the qualifying. So this is the aim we have, to be first and second row with both riders. And of course, in this area, in qualification, you are able to help each other. But at the moment, it's indeed that, we talk a lot about Vale, but Franco at the moment is the man in shape. And I also expect a lot from him this year, even with or without Valentino being there. But we already started to give Vale the position in the box, and he's replacing Fabio clearly, you know, because he's in the left side of the box. So we had a strategy for that. And not to forget Franco's performances, because he deserves a lot of credits what he did last year.
And talking Franco, we spoke with Mayo Merigali, team boss of the factory Yamaha squad, and he said that he has had an upgrade on the 2019. Could you give us a bit more details what that upgrade entails, how much of a boost that is for him as well, and how much of an advantage or a push it will be throughout 2021?
Well, clearly our bikes were not the fastest last year, and actually already yesterday it showed that Franco was the fastest Yamaha. So not just by lap time, but on top speed. And last year he wasn't. So clearly he had an engine with better performances and more speed. So I think in this area we're able to get better material from Yamaha. And don't ask me exactly what, because I don't know that information. And if I would know, I would not share. But clearly that he has more speed, and this is of course with our bike and our situation from last year very important.
Could that be the final piece to the puzzle for Franco?
Yeah, that could be, but yeah, still, if I saw the speeds yesterday from the red ones, they are still 10Ks faster. So we still need to continue and focusing on this area. Also, we have been winning races with these differences, but track by track, of course, it depends on which racetrack we are, because some racetrack like Austria is very important to have good speed.
And just finally, Wilco, before we let you go, we've got half a day left now. Three more days when we come back next week. At the end of those 3 days, what would you say would be a successful race for you? What would you be happy with achieved?
First of all, the boys need to be feeling comfortable with their bikes. So yesterday we did not struggle, but we were not the fastest. But they felt comfortable with the bikes, and that means they are able to improve and to push the bikes to their limits. And if you want to be respectable for the championship, especially for Franco, last year he did 53.8, and if the circumstances here are identical, this is our aim. The target from last year need to be actually destroyed.
Lovely. Thank you, Wilco. We appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
Pass the microphone over to Simon. We'll cleanse it first. And in the meantime, I can tell you exactly what's going on here in the cell before Simon comes into picture. I will see if I can look over my shoulder. No, I can't. I'll tell you the timing tower to be able to tell you exactly who's fastest at the moment. Can you see over your shoulder, Simon, what number's at the top of the timing tower at the moment, just so we can let the people know who is fastest here?
Oh,
we need glasses.
That's hard to see. It's single digit. It looks like a 4 or 5 or 6. It's in there, but I
know that Johan Zarco was the pace setter an hour ago. Whether that's still the case, we've been busy hurrying around speaking to team managers, and it might seem silly, but we actually forgot to look at the timesheets. Although
Wilco's a good man, isn't he? I'm glad you hit him on.
He's a fantastic guy and a great insight as well.
Yep. I first heard of him because in 93, my first season in Europe, I rode for Tech 3 on this Lucky Strike Suzuki.
Yep.
He was the rider on it the year before.
Right,
so
okay.
So I thought, and back then you didn't have internet, so you could only read stuff like that from magazines. And by the time the magazines got to New Zealand, I knew very little about the riders coming into Europe, but turned out a top man, really good to know him. Sorry, I'll just say one other thing about his new rider, Valentino. Yes. Been thinking about it a little bit. I reckon that this is his... if it's going to happen, that Valley gets his real mojo back and does something special, there's a good chance this is it. Because Ramon Forcada, the most experienced Yamaha crew chief in the paddock, by far, you know, then Valentino's crew chief used to work for him, so they know each other really well. I think there's going to be a rift. Franco and Valentino are good friends. It's going to be a great atmosphere in that garage. I think it could be something special.
And do we sometimes bypass how important that chemistry, that unity within a team can be?
Yeah, because the opposite is riders that hate each other and crew chiefs that don't want to share information. It's going to be the opposite. So good luck to Valley and Wilco.
Well, one to watch, certainly. We'll let you know in After the Flag, 8:30. Remember, here in Qatar, MotoGP.com, the place to be for that, where you'll actually hear the first interview that Valentino did with us late last night after the show went off air. A great insight of how he got on in his first day, so you don't want to miss that. Talking today, though, Simon, what do you think's been the biggest pulls, the biggest stories so far?
Well, there's been so much going on in pit lane.
Yeah.
Unlike the last 2 days, you know, where they've just been getting them back up to speed.
Feels like we've warmed up today properly, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, there's so many new things and things going on being tested that I forgot to have lunch. I only realised because I'm so hungry right now.
I was going to say, you're looking slim.
Don't lie, Jack. Hey, so, exciting things. Like last night, I really enjoyed watching the practice starts that, we showed on After the Flag, and we'll do it again tonight, because it was the first time I'd seen all the machines that have the start device, not only on the rear, but on the front, or some manufacturers the other way around, both ends. And you see the bike, like a dragster, strapped to the floor, you know, like, so not just the rear down, but the front down, or in Aprilia's case, not just the front down, but the rear. The Aprilia of Aleix was super impressive. They probably had more practice with it, having tested Jerez, but it, off like a scalded cat, really impressive. And this morning, it's looking right down the garage. It's not just Ducati. They've just turned up with the front one. Not just Aprilia. Not just Honda have got one now, but KTM have turned up with theirs as well. So you'll get to see it tonight on After the Flag.
Aside from that, though, Simon, we've got to talk about a whole host of other things as well on After the Flag tonight. I was going to ask you another question, but I'm getting the wrap-up signal. We've done 10 minutes. We've given you Wilco. We've given you a little bit of Simon. We don't want to give too much more away because you'll miss it on After the Flag tonight. Make sure you tune in then. 8:30 here in Qatar, 6:30 in Europe, 5:30 in the UK. Simon and myself, plus Neil and Lewis back in Barcelona. All of the analysis on the final day of the first test of 2021 in MotoGP. We'll see you there.